Let's go ahead and open in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you, God, just for what you allow us to be a part of. Thank you for your church, for calling us, for redeeming us through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you for calling us your own. I just pray for all of those children that we can hear laughing and having fun and seeing friends. God, I'm just thankful that they're going to be learning who you are tonight, that their small group leaders and teachers and storytellers and worship leaders will be pointing them to you. And I pray that your spirit would find fertile ground in the hearts of those children to work and move and draw them to you, that a new generation would rise up, would grow up knowing who you are, walking in the fear of you and serving you. And I just thank you for this time tonight, God, as we look into your word and look at the observance of the Lord's Supper, Christ's last time with the disciples. And as we just worship you tonight, I just pray, Father, that your spirit would move here. And I pray that you would speak to us, point out in our lives things that need to be in alignment with your word and draw us closer to you. We love you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So we are still in Acts chapter 2, verse 42. As we've done every week, I just want to read these verses. We've been studying them for several weeks now. I've lost track of the count, but Acts chapter 2, verse 42. That's where we've been working to, and I just want to read through this. So as you find your way there, I'm going to start reading. It says, they were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone kept feeling a sense of awe, and many wonders and signs were taking place through the apostles. And all those who had believed were together and had all things in common. And they began selling their property and possessions and were sharing them with all as anyone might have need. Day by day, continuing with one mind in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they were taking their meals together with gladness and sincerity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord was adding to their number, day by day, those who were being saved. If you just join us tonight for the first time on a Wednesday night, we've been studying through the first two chapters of Acts to get to these five verses that give us just a picture of the infancy, the birth of the church here on the earth. Christ has died, he has been buried, he has risen from the dead, he has ascended into heaven. The church in its infant stages after the preaching of Peter, testifying who Jesus Christ was, experienced this explosion of people believing and repenting and coming to faith in Christ. It says just a verse before we started in verse 41 that 3,000 souls were added to their number that day. So they have experienced this exponential growth. Then I look at these verses, you know, in 42, the ones we just read, I look at these verses, I'm just like, man, what do we have to learn from the infant stages of the church? When they were pure, when they didn't have 2,016 years of man's thoughts and man's ideologies and man's corruption. The Bible says hollow and deceptive philosophies of man just invading and perverting the word of God, and many pastors and priests and teachers and people in church leading people astray, leveraging the word of God to lead people astray and to lead them into sin. What can we learn when they simply lifted their eyes to heaven and sought the power of God? What can we learn from them and the way they lived their lives? So we looked through the first days, and now we are in a series that I just call Continually Devoted. It comes from the start of verse 42. They were continually devoting themselves to. We talked last week about how they in verse 42 are the believers that we find throughout chapter 1. There's like 120 or so of them that it talks about through chapter 1 and early chapter 2. And then those 3,000 who were added in verse 41. That is they, those who had placed their faith in Jesus Christ, those who had been redeemed, those who have come into the church of God as it grows and moves on the earth. They says, we're continually devoting themselves to, and I just was struck in my own life as I've been reading this and studying it for many weeks now, just continually devoting themselves. I don't ever just want to devote myself to something one time and just be like, I'm good. I want to continually understand the Lord in a new way. I want to continually understand how to seek him in new ways. I want to continually understand how to worship him and how to fellowship with believers in new ways, always working our way towards, closer towards Jesus Christ. He must be the center. And as we work toward leaving this earth and spending eternity with God in heaven, the redeemed forever, I always want to be continually devoting myself reminded, I said last week, of how the Bible tells us that the mercies of God are new every morning because we have failings every day and we find new mercies in God. We are called, we are His, we must be continually devoted. So last week we looked at the first two points in verse 42. They were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching. We talked about how the apostles' teaching is the word of Jesus Christ. He commissioned the disciples and said, go into all the world, preach the gospel to all creation, baptize new believers, and teach them everything I have commanded you. So their teaching, the apostles' teaching, was to be the teachings of Jesus Christ. They were devoted to the teachings of the apostles, the word of God. It says, and to fellowship. We talked last week about being devoted to one another. Mentioned that 59 times in the Bible, the phrase one another is used throughout scripture, talking about our relationship with one another. How if we aren't in fellowship with one another, then who are we in fellowship with? The world? Are we just around the sinful past that we've tried to get away from? Are we still ingrained in the pattern? The Bible would say the pattern of this world. Don't be conformed to that. Or are we in fellowship with believers who encourage us, who hold us accountable, that we can come alongside of and sometimes shed tears and walk through very dark days in life? Are we in fellowship with the body of Christ being built up to then go out into the world and evangelize for the cause of Jesus Christ? Tonight we find ourselves at this third point in verse 42. They were continually devoting themselves to the breaking of bread. I just want to talk about the Lord's Supper tonight. Maybe you know it by different names, the Lord's Supper, the Last Supper, communion. I read one today that I'd never heard of. So those who have been around church a lot longer than me, the Lord's Table. That was a new one on me. I'm like, wow, the Lord's Table. I guess it makes sense to me, but I've always, the Lord's Supper and communion, the Last Supper. Confirmed in all four Gospels. We're going to talk about some different points tonight. I was looking at them like, how do we talk about the Lord's Supper? Because it's kind of all throughout the Bible, so I had to kind of narrow it down. So we're going to talk about what is the Lord's Supper, with whom do we take the Lord's Supper, where do we take it, why do we take it, when do we take it, and how do we take it? So I was just like, wow, this grammar school rules, who, what, why, where, when, and how paid off for me today. So we're just going to look at those five questions, walk through this, and at the end of the night, we're going to partake in the Lord's Supper together. So first question, what is the Lord's Supper? What is it? Well, first, I wanted to say that it's confirmed in all four Gospels. We see in the different Gospel stories, we see different stories come from the writers of the Gospel. The Holy Spirit inspired men to record different accounts of Christ's life. The Gospel of John, at the end of the Gospel, he says that if it were to write everything down that Jesus did and said, there wouldn't be room in all the world. This is one of the things that the writers of the Gospels all talk about. They all talk about the Last Supper when they came together. You can find it for note takers in the room. I will try and give them slowly so you can scratch it out really quick. You can find the story in Matthew 26, 17 through 30. You can find it in Mark 14, 12 through 26. Luke 22, 1 through 20. And John chapter 13 through 17. So John spent a lot of time in the men's ministry. If there are any guys in the room, the men's ministry just wrapped up a teaching, many weeks teaching through the upper room, John 13 through 17. Confirmed in all four Gospels, also confirmed by Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, which we're going to take a look at a little bit more tonight. Just showing the authenticity of the scripture, five different men under the inspiration of one Holy Spirit recounting one event that happened. And I like that. People sometimes will work against the Bible, but we can look and we can see how the Bible is consistent. And I like this as one picture. Five different writers in scripture recording the same thing, verifying the same thing. It's great. All four Gospels at the end of the Lord's Supper confirm that when they left the upper room, that they went out to the Mount of Olives. Another thing that I just thought was interesting as I studied and read through this, that all four men were very careful about some of the things that took. They don't all say the same things about the Lord's Supper, but they talk about being in the upper room, they talk about leaving the upper room, where they went to, and what transpired after that. So what is the Lord's Supper? Well, the Lord's Supper, quite simply, is the last time that Jesus would sit and share a meal with the disciples. Quite simply, he would sit with them at the table the night that he was betrayed, and it would be the last time that he would commune with them, the last time that he would instruct them, he would pray for them, he would teach them. The Lord's Supper is the last time that Jesus would sit at that table before his death, because then he shows up after his resurrection, and a cool story happens about him showing up and breaking bread. And they're like, the Lord is great, great story. The last time is taken at the time of the Passover meal. We studied a few weeks ago in Acts chapter 2, the day of Pentecost, and we talked about these different feasts that take place and how they relate to the time of the crucifixion. So when Christ shares the Passover meal with his disciples, they come together for the purpose of the Passover. They share that meal. Jesus says, I have long desired to share this meal with you. He didn't show up and be like, that's the old stuff, out with the old, in with the new. They show up and they observe the Passover. And as we'll see, Paul records later that after supper, he took the bread, he took the cup. That's very important to me. Sometimes you'll hear people say that the Passover became obsolete when Jesus came and gave the Lord's Supper. It doesn't become obsolete, it becomes complete. And there's a very different nature in those two words. The Passover wasn't eradicated, it was completed. Jesus coming, and now Jesus, the Passover lamb, the blood of Jesus Christ that would cover our sins so that the judgment of God would pass over us. Passover does not become obsolete, it becomes complete. What is the Lord's Supper? The Lord's Supper is our proclamation of the Lord's death until he comes. We're going to look at this verse again tonight in 1 Corinthians 11:26. Paul writes, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Why do we proclaim the Lord's death? So that sinners might know that they can be set free from their sin. It is through the death of Jesus Christ that we find forgiveness. The power of sin is broken. The power of death, where, O death, is your sting. The power of death, the power of sin, the power of hell broken, and new life, reconciliation now offered to man to approach the Father through Jesus Christ. We studied in Ephesians last spring how it is by the grace of God through faith in Jesus Christ that we are saved. The shed blood of Jesus Christ, proclaiming his death, the breaking of the bonds of sin. That's what we are proclaiming when we observe the Lord's Supper. I sometimes read different commentaries, and one that I like to go to because he wrote a long time ago, and he speaks, just kind of like an old English word sometimes, which I like. I think about my great-great-great-grand relatives over in England, and sometimes when I read, I nerd out and try to talk with an English accent. It's fun, but I was reading him today. His name's Matthew Henry, just a man who wrote and researched and gave some insight, just a man. But this is what he said, and I liked his observation here. He says in his commentary of the Lord's Supper, he says, "The Lord's Supper is a sermon to the eye and a confirmation of God's word to us, and it is an encouragement to our prayer and a solemn expression of the ascent of our soul to God." I read that, I said, wow, I really like that. Lord's Supper is a sermon to the eye. Like we're gathered here, and in a little while we'll partake of bread and cup, just as the disciples partook of bread and cup. Jesus broke bread, he gave them the bread, he poured the cup, and he gave them the cup and told them what that symbolized, what those things represented, what they meant. And so when we gather and we partake in communion, we have a symbol of the body of Jesus Christ, and we have a symbol of the blood of Jesus Christ where we find our redemption. I thought about that for a minute, like, wow, a sermon to the eye. That's powerful. And he says, and a confirmation of God's word to us. Just the enduring nature of the word of God confirmed through this act of worship. We come before God in a holy manner, as holy as we can, approaching the throne humbly, mindful of sin, repentant of sin, approaching God, confirming his word to us. And then that last line, in a day and age where there's a lot of discouragement, the Lord's Supper is encouragement to our prayer. Why? We spend time praying over people, over things, over whatever, you name it. We pray over a lot of stuff, but we pray over, God, your will be done. And eventually the Lord's will be done. And we have the hope of the resurrection when we will join the Lord for eternity, and encouragement to our prayer amidst all of the awful things that we know in this life. The Lord's Supper is an encouragement to our prayer, and he says, a solemn expression of the ascent of our souls to God. That one line for me, I read that there's a lot of people trying to ascend to the Lord intellectually. And it is the heart, it is the soul that ascends before God. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul. I read that, and I'm like, wow, that guy a long time ago, like 1500 something, wrote that, and it just kind of encouraged me today. That's what the Lord's Supper is. The Lord's Supper, the last time that Jesus would sit with his disciples and giving us an observance, a commemoration of his sacrifice for us that has endured, well, here we are, to this day. With whom do we take it, and where do we partake in the Lord's Supper? Well, the simple answer is among the church, among those who are the redeemed of Jesus, among those who by faith have believed in the resurrected Savior, the risen Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, and have received the grace of God on their life. That's who we take communion with. Now, where that is, I don't know, wherever you find yourself in fellowship with believers is where. Like, some of these answers are really simple, which I'm glad for, because some are a little longer, but we take communion among the body of believers. If you're not a believer in Jesus Christ, then this is just a silly tradition. This is just a ritual that men have been practicing for thousands of years, but when you believe in the Lord Jesus, all of a sudden it becomes a command of Christ, it becomes obedience to Christ, and it becomes a very solemn commemoration of his sacrifice for us, something that we partake in. We don't just read, we don't just receive the grace, we partake in the Lord's Supper. We take it among the church. Where? Wow, complicated, convoluted, regulated, restricted by man. I mean, I don't know what you've grown up around or grown up in. My good friend, I just saw him in the back, my good friend Neil Thompson, we were talking about communion a lot today, he and I. He's like, man, the way I grew up, the religion I was around growing up, like you had to come up a certain way, you had to hold a certain way, you had to put it in your mouth a certain way, you had to walk a certain way, you had to say certain things. Like just over and over and over and over, man just inserting themselves into what was already pure and holy from God, already given by God, and man saying, I've got a better idea for this. Let's do this. Let's, what does the Bible say? Tie up heavy burdens. Let's place these things on man. With whom do we take it? There are churches, I'm sorry, that if you go into, you would not be allowed to partake in communion because you are not a member there. That's not biblical. And I don't want to say that what they're doing is wrong. It's just not biblical. And I don't know if we should be restricting who can partake in communion. If they say, I believe in Jesus Christ, the risen Savior, may I share in communion. I believe, yes, you should, and yes, you can. There's no specified place in all of the Bible where the Lord's Supper is to take place. Like some people might think, we only take it on Sunday, right? We only take it within the church walls, right? I mean, yeah, that's great. But that's not a restriction that has to be placed on us as believers in Jesus Christ. I have some friends from my wife's past. I knew them. She knew them much better than me. They were on a mission trip in Mexico or South America or, I don't know, someplace remote. They were south of the U.S. anyway. And after a day of evangelizing, after a day of witnessing and ministering to people and people confessing Christ and people coming to salvation, they all were moved to observe communion. Like, they were in the middle of nowhere, and they were just moved to observe. They didn't have crackers and juice. They were like, what can we observe communion with here? And they literally, they had a bottle of water and a Snickers bar, and some people might be like, how irreverent, how dare they? Not to them in that moment. They went before a holy God. They're like, Lord, this is all we have, but we want to worship you in this way. We want to remember what you did, what we saw you do in the lives of these people today. Like, there are people who will discredit that and will discount that. And I don't know if we should do that. I don't think that we should impose ourselves on something that is so simply given by Jesus Christ to his followers. With whom do we take it? The church. Where? Wherever the church gathers. Wherever the church is at. I was in Mexico a few years ago, and every Sunday morning at this church that we visited in Mexico, every Sunday morning, they have a separate service where people come together and they observe the Lord's Supper. Not everyone comes to it every week. But they gather for the sole purpose of remembering the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ through observing the Lord's Supper. We took communion there with them. It was a beautiful time of worship. We take communion here once a month. We observe communion as a church. This coming weekend, the church will gather and we'll observe communion. We take that here, but you could take that anywhere. The Bible doesn't impose where you should and you should not. So some people might ask the question, because I've been asked, well, what if I go into a church and they tell me that I can't take communion? Do I raise a fuss and tell them, yes, I can? Well, the Bible says to live peaceably with all men, and I don't think you should fight over the Lord's Supper. If they say no, I think that you should be polite. I think that you should be respectful. I think that you should worship God in your heart. We don't restrict people here. If believers in Jesus Christ come into this building and we're observing communion, they're welcome to take communion here, because we see in the Bible where it is for those who believe. It is for the redeemed. The Bible says in verse 42 of Acts chapter 2, they, the redeemed of Jesus Christ, were continually devoting themselves to the breaking of bread. Not just they, the 12 apostles. Not just they, the 120 in the upper room. They, all those who had believed, that probably could not partake in communion in one place at one time. Where do we take it? Well, even right here in the Bible, we see down in verse 46 of Acts chapter 2. Day by day, continuing with one mind in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they were taking their meals together with gladness and sincerity of heart. They were not even confined to a place. People have asked me, we're going to talk about, in a little bit, we're going to talk about, how often, or is there a frequency that we should do this? People will sometimes be like, well, how often do you think we should partake in the Lord's Supper? I'm like, I don't know if there's a right or wrong here, but I have a feeling that these people that we're reading about in these verses, I think that they probably had the Lord's Supper every single time they came together. I believe that they came together, and because they had just watched, 60 days before, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and just a week before had seen the ascension of him into heaven, I believe that every time they came together, they were observing the Lord's Supper. With whom do we take it? The church. Where? Wherever the church is. Why? Why do we partake in the Lord's Supper? One, very simply, because Jesus says, do this. There are a lot of other words that surround what he says right there. He breaks bread, he pours a cup, he gives to his disciples, and he says, do this. It's not something that can just be left out of Christian church culture. It's not just it's inconvenient for us to do, or we don't know how to do it, or we don't know when to do it, or we don't know what to do. Like Jesus says, do this. As often as you do it, do this in remembrance of me. We come together and we observe the Lord's Supper because Christ has said, do this. And Paul says, by so doing, we proclaim his death until he comes. Luke and Paul, both again, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, record the words of Christ, do this in remembrance of me. It's interesting, as I thought about these two things, that I don't want a side tangent here, but I kind of thought more about the authenticity of the Bible. And how people want to debate it and want to refute it and want to claim that it's not true and that it's not, doesn't flow, it's not congruent, there are discrepancies. These two men, Luke and Paul, who knew each other, they wrote separate letters. We've talked about, because Luke is the author here in Acts, how he wrote a very carefully researched, almost account of Jesus. And he records the words of Christ as being, do this in remembrance of me. Paul would later, a different man, would later write to a church, not a report, not his findings of what the disciples did in the upper room. He would write to them a letter encouraging and instructing them how to observe the Lord's Supper. And he would say, the Lord, in the night he was betrayed, took the bread, he broke it, gave thanks, and said, do this in remembrance of me. Why do we partake in the Lord's Supper? Because the Lord has said, do this. Awesome to see the authenticity of the Bible played through. Why do we take the Lord's Supper? Because it is a testimony to those who gather to see us proclaim the death of the Lord. Proclaim always the death of the Lord. Paul would write, I carry around always. I determine to know nothing but him crucified. We always are to proclaim the death of Jesus, thereby also proclaiming the burial and resurrection of Jesus so that people can find forgiveness for sin. Why? The Lord said so. It's really that simple. There's not another why to answer in the scripture. When do we partake the Lord's Supper? One of the most common questions asked, if you were to talk to Pastor Wes, you ask me, Brian, anybody in the church who gets asked questions by new people to the church, how often do you guys take communion? What about communion at the Rock Church? It's just a very common question. And it used to be that people would say, we noticed that we've been here a while and we haven't seen communion. How often do we take it? Well, we never have really had a schedule until we simply were burdened to say, we need to partake in the Lord's Supper more frequently as a church. And the reason we didn't have a schedule is because the Bible doesn't say you must come together and take communion X amount of times or every week or every third Sunday, Saturday of the month. Like, the Bible doesn't say that. There is no prescribed frequency of the observance of the Lord's Supper. Now, many people will use Acts chapter 20, verse 7 as a guide to how often we should take communion. And I don't fault them for that. If they draw from this and they practice this, I think that's okay. Acts chapter 20, verse 7 says, on the first day of the week, when we were gathered together to break bread. Now, some people use that as a guide. Some people use that as a rule. Others won't use it at all. What do I believe when I read that? I believe that that body of believers was not in Jerusalem. I cannot remember where they were located. Acts chapter 20, so they were somewhere around, I think that they were in Ephesus at that time. It's the same story where Eutychus falls to his death because Paul preaches until like midnight, which is crazy. Wes and I would love it if you'd let us preach to midnight sometime. It says that they gathered together. I think this was their custom. This was what they did. That body of believers there, when they gathered together on the first day of the week, they came together. Joe, Frank, how you doing? Doing really well. Let's go before the Lord and proclaim the death of Jesus Christ until he returns. And they gathered to break bread. Luke simply records Jesus as saying, do this in remembrance of me. No frequency. Christ did not tell the disciples, every time you gather, once a week. He did not say those words. He said, do this in remembrance of me. If you want to turn in your Bibles, we're going to spend the rest of our time in 1 Corinthians tonight. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. These chapters in the Bible are often referred to as order of worship. And I love it, and I'm going to explain briefly why I love one of these verses that's found here. Luke records Jesus simply saying, do this in remembrance of me. Paul, the same thing. And when he starts this portion of the letter, he comes into, I guess I got to give a little background here. The church in Corinth was a disaster. Like, they were a mess. Like, you can look at the American church and be like, wow, the American church has got it messed up. They are wrong. They don't know what they're doing. It's a mess. When we read Corinth, I read biblical evidence of what I see now in a lot of the churches that we know. I see a lot of the same things that were happening in Corinth happening now in the church in America, and I see Paul instructing them in the ways of the Lord, and I think that is what pastors and teachers and shepherds need to be doing now. We don't need to make things up. We just need to instruct people in the Word of God. So Paul, in verse 11, he's trying to correct things. When the Corinthian church was coming together to observe the Lord's Supper, they were just getting drunk and eating bread. There was nothing holy about what they were doing. They were treading underfoot, as I think Hebrews says. Things that were holy. They were walking on the holy things of God just because they regarded their flesh as more important, as more valuable. And Paul comes in to instruct them, to correct them. Chapter 11, verse 23. And this is what I love about this passage, this opening line. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you. You know what that is? Paul didn't receive instruction from Peter about the Lord's Supper. Paul didn't receive instruction from John about the Lord's Supper. Like, I don't know when or where. There's speculations about how Paul receives. He says, I received from the Lord. Like, this is like one-on-one talking time, you understand. And I love that. Because sometimes I think we look at the Bible and we're like, man, I wish I could hear from God that way. And we can. And I seek to. And I hope that you do too. I seek that one-on-one time where when I sit, where when I commune with the Lord, he speaks, and I listen, and I hope you desire that in your life. But Paul says here, I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you. So he says to them, listen, this isn't just something that man made up. God told me how this works, and then I came to you and said, this is what you do. I also delivered to you that the Lord Jesus, in the night he was betrayed, took the bread. And we step into our last point tonight. How do we partake of the Lord's Supper? I'm going to read a series of verses here, and then we'll talk about them. And then he was betrayed, he took the bread, verse 24. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Paul writes, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Verse 27, "Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But a man must examine himself, and in so doing he is to eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks judgment to himself if he does not judge the body rightly. For this reason, many among you are weak and sick, and a number sleep or are dead. But if we judged ourselves rightly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are disciplined by the Lord so that we will not be condemned along with the world." How do we partake of the Lord's Supper? I believe that communion elements, to the best of our ability, should be bread and some sort of cup of the fruit of the vine, as I remember learning as a young child, because that's what Christ used, and that's the only reason that I have to say that. So to the people that used a Snickers bar and a bottle of water, I have no condemnation on them. I don't have anything, and I don't see where, oh, they were in violation. How dare they do that? They were eating and drinking judgment. No. But I do believe that if Christ used bread, which we know this happened at the time of the Passover, so bread then was unleavened. And in the Bible, if you're around it a short time or a long time, leaven in the bread is a representation of sin. And Jesus was a man just like us, yet without sin. And when he broke bread and gave to his disciples, he gave them bread that didn't have a representation of sin in it. And I think that's kind of powerful and awesome. Even in the Lord's Supper observance, Jesus doesn't just grab any old loaf of bread. Like at Passover time, Jews are not allowed to have yeast in the home. Leaven, yeast, same difference here. They're not allowed to even have that in the home. So bread would have been made without yeast, without leaven. And he gave that to them. Even in his demonstration, he was without a representation of sin. That's incredible. I believe it should be bread and a cup of the fruit of the vine. We use grape juice here. In Mexico, they used wine, real deal wine. Many churches do. Many use juice, many use wine. Whatever they do, I don't have a judgment on that either. I believe we should do that because that's what the Lord shows us in the Bible. He took bread, he took the cup. He gave it and said, "Here, eat this. It represents my body." What do we learn about the body of Jesus? We learn he himself bore our punishment in his body on the cross. When he broke that bread and gave it to the disciples, he was literally showing them an example of, "I will be broken for you. I will be ripped for you." Isaiah talks about how we are healed by the stripes. We are healed by his crushing. We are forgiven. We are saved by what he bore on the cross. So when he ripped that bread, that was an illustration of him giving himself for us. He poured the wine. He poured the cup. He gave it to them. "This cup is the new covenant in my blood," erasing the old covenant that was found in the blood of man through the act of circumcision, erasing that. God came to Abraham. He said, "This will be a sign in your flesh. All of your men do this practice." That's no longer the sign. Now it is my blood. So I said earlier that Passover does not become obsolete. It becomes complete. Passover now comes to all of humanity, where before it was only to the Jews. Now it is to all men. He took the bread, he took the cup, he gave it to them. We learn throughout Scripture about what the Lord endured on the cross. How do we partake? We partake with elements representing the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. Actual distribution, ways that we take it, methods that we approach it, nothing in the Bible. It says he broke the bread and gave it to them. It says he poured a cup and he gave it to them. Like the nonsense. My friend Neil saying you had to walk a certain way and hold a certain way and put it in your mouth a certain way and hop up and down and turn around and do all these things. I don't know, man. Like, That's just a heavy burden. We approach communion in holiness. All of my life growing up, communion was a very somber, sullen, almost like, wow, are we at a funeral right now? Like, it was always like that. As I got older, I started to see more of the beauty and more of the energy that comes from observing communion, realizing what we are doing. It is not just it's communion time. We are proclaiming the death of Jesus Christ so that those who may even be in this very room that don't know who Jesus is, maybe their eyes will be opened to the Savior through our proclamation of the death of Jesus Christ. We approach it in holiness. It is more important to understand the manner in which we approach and take the Lord's Supper than it is to understand what we take and where it's taken and in what way we take it. It's more important to understand how we come to take it. Verse 27, therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. I'd like to simplify that for you. Get sin out of your life. You don't approach the holiness of God, proclaiming the death of Jesus Christ, while you are living in sin. If you are the redeemed of Jesus, you ought to be dead to sin in the first place. But when we gather, he says here to the Corinthian church, who apparently had just the same problems that we do, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner. Well, what is an unworthy manner? To take the cup while there is sin in the life. When you are hiding, when you are not confessing, when you're not emptying yourself of yourself and taking the Lord's yoke upon you, you have not done that and you are coming to the Lord's Supper. He says, if you do that, you are guilty of the blood and the body of the Lord. Verse 28. So what do we do about that then? Verse 28, but a man must examine himself. And in so doing, he is to eat the bread and drink of the cup. We say these words every time that we gather to observe communion. Because we would rather have someone who has got some sort of sin issue in them not approach the Lord's Supper than to approach it in an unworthy manner. Because this is the Lord who changes not. I am the same yesterday, today, and forever. And later on, I read that as the Corinthian church was approaching the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner, many of them were sick and dying. How dare we think that we are different to approach a holy God in all of his holiness with sin in our heart? That terrifies me. Lord, I want to be clean before you. I want to be pure before you. I want to be holy before you. If there is something in me that is offensive, David prayed, if there is an offensive thing in me, show it to me, Lord. Show me what is offensive. Point out my sin, my error, and I will clean it before you by your word. For he who eats and drinks judgment to himself if he does not judge the body rightly. Are you judging yourself rightly? Are you realizing your sin before the Lord, or are you justifying your sin before the Lord? Are you allowing the word of God to be uncomfortable in your life to move sin out? Are you just stuck trying to serve two masters internally? And I'm here to tell you from my own personal confession, that's a disaster, and it's the worst feeling inside ever. And you're just like, I'm going to just let sin and Jesus hang out in one space. No, you're not. You are not going to do that. We cannot approach the holiness of God with sin. It says in verse 30, for this reason, many among you are weak and sick, and a number sleep. If we judged ourselves rightly, we would not be judged. If we looked at ourselves against the measure of the word of God and judged ourselves rightly, there would be no judgment for us. We would make corrections in our life. We would move the sin out of our life as the word of God instructs us, as the Holy Spirit convicts us of things that are not in alignment with him. We would move those things out and there would be no judgment. If we judged ourselves rightly. But when we are judged, we are disciplined by the Lord so that we will not be condemned along with the world. Notice the difference in that statement right there. People sometimes are like, sin and judgment and death. Did you notice what's said in that verse? When we are judged, we are disciplined by the Lord so that we will not be condemned with the world. Those who have by faith believed in Jesus Christ and are pursuing a standard of righteousness and are living according to the word of God and are lifting their eyes to God on high are not condemned as the world is, but you may experience discipline in your life. And discipline is uncomfortable. When we are judged, we are disciplined by the Lord so that we will not be condemned with the world. How do we approach communion in holiness with reverence for who God is? After searching our heart, we gather and we say these words. We're just going to take a minute to pray for you to examine your heart. And it takes that long for you to call on the Holy Spirit and know if there's something wrong between you and God. It's not like, well, I don't know if there's sin in me. When you open your heart and your mind before the Holy Spirit of God and say, Father, show me if there is any offensive or wicked way in me, I promise you, he's going to show you. Each person is going to have to examine their heart. Each person is going to have to understand where they stand to the best of their ability before God. And we approach with holiness and with reverence to proclaim the death, the burial of Jesus Christ, and the power of his resurrection. We're going to observe communion here tonight, and we're going to do this in a different way than we ever have before. Just a Wednesday night. There's not going to be any music. We're not going to sing. I'm just going to call for a time of prayer. The Bible says, examine yourself. The Bible says, judge rightly. So we're going to pray, and I'm going to allow you all to sit, just you and the Holy Spirit, and examine your heart. And go before the throne of God and allow him to stir where you're at. Maybe you have some things to repent of. Maybe you have something to confess of before a holy God. Maybe you're like, wow, if I need to approach him in holiness, I've got something that I don't really want anybody to know about, but it's not holy. We're going to come before the Lord in a time of prayer, and then as you are ready, these elements are here for you to partake in. There's not going to be any ushers coming up the aisles. Nobody's going to pass anything out. No pressure of everybody's looking at me. This plate's going by me. And people are going to know I got sin in my life. None of that. You and the Lord. Examining your heart. Examining your life. And when you are ready, come up the side, come up the middle, whatever you want to do. Come and partake in the Lord's Supper. Come and worship. Proclaim the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the shed blood of Jesus Christ in your life for the forgiveness of sin. I'm going to open us in prayer, and then I'm just going to allow you to be with the Lord and to observe communion as you are moved by the Holy Spirit. Heavenly Father, God, you are sovereign and you are seated on the throne. And forgive us, Lord, for ever approaching you in an unholy, unworthy manner. And I pray, Father, that in this moment, as many hearts come before you, that your Holy Spirit would speak. Father, that as your word has said, as Jesus Christ has spoken, the Spirit comes and will convict. Father, I pray that you would point anything out in our hearts and our lives. I pray, God, that we would be found right before you, that we would be living as pure and as holy as we can. I pray for any in the room, God, that maybe don't know you. Perhaps your Spirit is drawing them and their eyes are open for the first time. I pray, God, that they would believe in their heart that Jesus Christ was risen from the dead. They would confess with their mouth that Jesus is Lord, that they would find fellowship here among a body of believers, that they would be able to partake in the Lord's Supper as well, Father. I pray that you would move and that you would speak in Jesus' name.